And now the end is near.
It is 8:07 on a Wednesday morning here on the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 1050. WTKA online at WTK.com. We're live here inside the Suburban Chevrolet Make the Choice Studios. And that's the theme music, the intro music. For our next guest, you hear him every Wednesday, top of the 8 o'clock hour. Marcus Ray for some rays of light. Marcus is brought to you by the Sports Bar Westside. That's where you can see Marcus from time to time. Isn't that right, M-Ray 29?
That's right, Sam. I'll be there Friday. I'll be there Saturday, man. So it's just one of those things. Being as my guy, I love going to the sports bar. What's the good news, Sam?
Oh, good news. I don't know about
it's Wednesday?
Yeah, it's Wednesday. Exactly. We're above ground.
The good news is we get Marcus Ray for the next 15, 20 minutes.
Yeah, that's right, Marcus. And because we have that window, I want to jump right into a few topics. We'll certainly get into what your man Foote had to say last week, because that was your homework assignment. But before we get to that, the most recent thing with Michigan, the Frank Clark situation. Obviously, he's been removed from the team. I'm curious your thoughts on that and what you think the future holds for Frank.
Well, my number one thought is it's very unfortunate that a young man will put himself in that position this late in his career. I stay away from all the details of it and what's right and what's wrong. I stay out of that. But I think it's unfortunate that it happened the way it did. And see, there's a difference between a poor choice and a mistake. I think a mistake is exactly that. It's a mistake. But a poor choice is something that you actually put some thought into before you did it. And it probably disregarded the consequences. But I would like to see Frank graduate. I'm not sure if he still will be able to get drafted, due to all the stuff that's happening with the National Football League. But I think he will be able to walk into somebody's camp and get invited as a free agent. But more importantly, whatever happened, I wish all parties involved all the best. I hope he didn't do what they said he did. And even if he did, then he deserves any punishment that comes along with that. And not only just punishment, but I think counseling and all the other services that may be needed. But I just wish everyone involved the best, and I think it's unfortunate, and I think Brady Hoke did what he had to do.
Right. I think you hit the nail on the head when you said, if you're guilty of something like this, the consequences are the consequences. You should pay the price. But then, there's the other end of this where, look, there will be an opportunity for a reprieve, for a comeback. What would your advice be? How do you hit the comeback trail, Marcus? What do you do, even if you go undrafted? How do you put that opportunity back on the table for yourself if you're Frank Clark?
Well, I'll tell you what Lloyd Carr told me, and I didn't deal with this in college, but I dealt with something different. Lloyd Carr always said that Marcus Ray was at his best when his back was to the wall. That's why he kept my back to the wall throughout my entire college career. And normally, when things are falling apart, they might be falling into place. And so because we live this life on a continuum, this is all part of Frank's growth. So what I would suggest is Frank definitely get counseling or get some type of service that will help him as a young man, but also shed a positive light from his future employer, showing that he has taken the necessary steps or he cares enough or has empathy to at least better himself or show some remorse. But what you do is you turn up physically. He needs to go start training right away. I'm not sure when he graduates or what's going on with that, but if he wants to really play at the next level, then when the pro day comes around, or maybe even the combine, he still may get invited to the combine. It's just a matter of if someone will take him. He has to be leaps and bounds off the chart to pass up or even get drafted to have a chance. He still may get drafted late. But he has to be a peak performer whenever the pro scouts come to watch him. But more importantly, he needs to finish school so he can graduate just in case things don't go right athletically. He can just walk right into the corporate world. You don't want to be a guy who leaves school without his degree. The NFL fails, and now you got to come back to school and go through all that. Frank definitely needs a number one finish up, get some help, and then stay low-key, stay out of the way, and then move forward athletically, and hopefully someone gives him a shot. And once he gets a shot, once you get there, all is forgiven. If you sign a free agent contract, they're saying, this is your shot. We're just not going to invest no money into you, but here's your shot, and then you turn up.
Gotcha. We're talking to Marcus Ray here on the Michigan Insider. Sports Talk 1050 WTKA online at WTK.com. So, Marcus, last week, you know, I know a really, really, really good friend of yours, former teammate of yours, Larry Foote, you know, offered some commentary on what he saw wrong with the recruiting model at Michigan. I'm curious, in looking back on his comments, what you think of them, and when you talk to him, what he had to say about it, and whether or not you agree.
Number one, I think to put Larry's comments in the context, when you say Michigan has too many trust fund babies, he's speaking from a trust fund baby mentality. Guys who have it all or don't want to play at the next level, or, you know, a lot of times when we were coming up, it was NFL or bust. Now it's not that way. Some guys are just happy to be at Michigan. Do I agree with Larry? Partly so. As far as the trust fund baby mentality, I know some people try to flip that into a racial thing, which I think is preposterous. So, but you got to know Larry. You got to understand where he's coming from. 80 to 85% of the National Football League are players who come from impoverished backgrounds. You can go research it. You can check it out. But that's but Larry speaking from that perspective, where he doesn't think Michigan has guys who have NFL caliber talent, NFL caliber mentality, and they don't really care about winning because their life is already kind of set. Hey, if you come from a pretty comfortable background, then you know what, football's not that important. Winning, okay. But if you got some kids that come from Pershing High School, just like Larry, you understand when Larry speaks. He's speaking from his perspective. Growing up, hard in Detroit, all right, gang-banging, doing all kind of stuff, turning his life around. A kid that wasn't supposed to make it comes to Michigan and says, maybe I don't know if I can survive academically, but I'm going to do what I got to do and go out there and knock some people out because he wants to go to the pros, and that's why he's a 13-year pro vet right now. So do I agree? I agree with the trust fund baby mentality. Yeah, I don't think Michigan has guys that honestly want to play at the next level or have the skill set to play at the next level. That's just me. So when everybody says, you know, he and I talk about this all the time. Oh, Michigan has talent. What kind of talent? Because I need you to qualify it. Because you can say they have 7-6 talent or they have 10-2 talent or just below Ohio State talent. Like, we got to place it somewhere so it can make sense. And it's not – they have enough talent to win. Win what? The Big Ten, the playoff, national championship, Minnesota game? What kind of talent? So Larry and I think, are on the same page that Michigan just don't have the type of guys that you need to win a championship from a mentality standpoint. And then physically looking at them, maybe they should win. Maybe they should be a 9-3 team. But to say they should be winning Big Ten championships with that talent, I think, is ludicrous. That's just what I think. And that's where Larry was coming from, too. So that's where I am with that.
All right, so let's – is this a matter of where you recruit or who you recruit? And here's why I ask that, Marcus. Michigan has a ton of players from Detroit. Michigan has – they have players that hail from Saginaw. You know, they have guys that come from – that have come from the type of background that you're talking about, and yet the production isn't on the field. So is it where you recruit or is it who you recruit?
I think it's who you recruit. And it's not really like where you're from that makes you a certain way. It's really been able to identify a mentality or recruit personality or character within a kid. It doesn't matter if he's from wherever, you know. I mean, Glenn Steele was from the sticks of Indiana. I'm talking about the slums. And he had that renegade mentality. So he's not a trust fund baby. So you can go to the sticks of Indiana and find Glenn Steele. That's what you do. Or you can go to the Bay Area, a really nice, comfortable area, and go find you an Amani Toomer. But the point is, it's a mentality that you're looking for. So it doesn't really matter where you're from, Sam. It's just Michigan has to identify those difference makers, guys who I think when you watch them on tape, you can say the number one question is, well, there's two questions when you recruit. Can this guy play on Sunday, and can he get into school? If you can answer those two questions, now that gives you a jump start in recruiting. And some people throw it at me, well, how do you know if a guy's going to the NFL from high school? Because you have to have football eyes. And it's not always 100%, but it's not always a crapshoot either. I was sitting in the meeting room when Butch Jones recruited Eric Fisher, and his name came up. And three coaches said, he is a Sunday guy with two offers right now. Y'all can have all these other guys. I was there when they went to, was it Fostoria or something like that, and they recruited Micah Hyde. That's how Butch Jones was thinking, and look at Micah Hyde. Turned down, almost came to Central, went to Iowa, and now he's out there making plays at the National Football League. So it doesn't matter where you're from. It's can you identify talent to go with a mentality, and what is that kid's upside potential? Just like Sam, everybody got mad at me on Twitter, because way before Melvin Gordon ran for 408, I said, I think David Cobb has the most upside potential at the next level. And people, all the Twitter trolls who halfway don't know nothing anyway, don't understand what upside potential means. I wasn't saying he was better than Melvin Gordon. At the college level, no. But looking in between the tackles and watching how Cobb run, I think he's going to be a guy out of the Big Ten running backs now that we're still going to be talking about a few years from now. So it's not where you're from, it's who you are, and the guys, but you got to have coaches that know how to identify that. So those guys from Cass Tech, all those guys that are on Cass Tech, from Cass Tech that are on Michigan's team, name one guy that looks like an NFL player.
KD, Jordan Lewis.
Okay, that's one out of how many? Eight. So it's kind of what, so when you're one out of eight from one school, and you got nothing to show for it, no all-conference, no Big Ten championships, no real pipeline, and I'm not taking no shot at Cass. I'm just saying it don't matter if you're from Detroit or not. It's how you think, how you play, and what you want while you're at Michigan. I don't care where you're from. I'm from Columbus. I knew I was going to the pros when I was seven. So, I was going to the pros at 7 years old. I was like, I'm going to Michigan. I'm going to be the best, and I'm going to the pros. So it didn't matter. And I'm not from the slums, but I'm not from a trust fund either. So what I had a type of mentality was, I'm going to go up there and shake it up. And we had guys from all over. Tom Brady, I mean, he grew up pretty comfortable. And he went on to make a few tens of millions of dollars because it's a certain mentality and competitive nature. It ain't where you're from, but it's who you are and how you think and play.
All right. So, Marcus, a couple of things real quick as we round things out. We're talking to Marcus Ray here on the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 1050 WTKA online at WTKA.com. You know, that Melvin Gordon performance, some believe that makes him a Heisman Trophy front runner. It was unbelievable to see him have a couple of fumbles and still run for that many yards. I'm curious. I don't know if you watched that game yet, but he had 238 yards in the first half rushing. It seems to me that you get to a point where you say, all right, well, I'm going to make this guy who couldn't throw a 10-yard pass 2 weeks ago, I'm making him have to throw to beat me. And I think they took that approach, and he still ran all over him. The Nebraska's guys, did they just quit? They just quit out there when a guy, you know, how does a guy run for 408 yards on you?
408 yards and three quarters, Sam. Now, you know that those Nebraska guys quit. What do they always do? They did it 2 years ago in a Big Ten championship game. Nebraska is going to the black shirt defense. I got a different name for them, but I told people I wouldn't say it no more. It ain't the black shirt. They just put a K in there. So my thing is, we know Nebraska's going to quit. And first of all, in those type of conditions, when it gets cold out there, don't nobody want to tackle Sam. Well, you're already kind of soft anyways, except for Randy Gregory on defense. And then it get cold. People don't want to tackle under those conditions. Nebraska had that game under control early. And my hat goes off to Wisconsin for saying, you know what, man, let's just flathead, as Reggie McKenzie would say. Let's just drive their mouth in the ground because they are who we thought they were. And to do it in three quarters, I wish Melvin Gordon would have went for 500 yards. I mean, I would have loved to see that record go get broken and shattered and burned up like forever. Like, let's never bring it up again. But it doesn't surprise me. Nebraska's notorious for giving up something like this to, single game records, just getting smashed around. And people think I don't like Nebraska. No, I just think they get too much credit and they haven't done nothing. Nebraska's not that 95 Nebraska team that I think was probably the best college team ever. This isn't the same Nebraska. Name brand's the same, yeah, but when you're still on the field, and it's the same thing with Michigan. You see what I'm saying? So I'm to the point where when you look at programs like Michigan, they kind of remind me of, may she rest in heaven, like Whitney Houston. She was just, in the 80s, it was, that's Whitney. But then a little bit later on, the next couple of decades, it was, that's what, she was cold, you know what I'm saying? But that's who Michigan is, like Whitney Houston in college football. and when I look at Nebraska, looking at that 408-yard performance that they gave, that they surrendered, and that's Bobby Brown. So, so Whitney and Bobby is Nebraska and Michigan. And that's just, and I'm an analyst. I don't have to protect anybody. That's how I truly feel. But when you give up 408 yards, or you go out here and you're 5-5 and you're losing all these things, and your program used to be good, then I can compare you to anybody. I can make any analogy I want. But Nebraska, still got a chance to win the West. That's what's sad.
Right.
It's still a first place and the three teams in second place. It's going to be a showdown in the West. And I'm looking forward to seeing that thing.
All right, Marcus, tell folks when the next time you're going to be on the Big Ten Network.
Man, I have a real busy slate coming up. Honestly, today I'm speaking to Northville High School hockey team, thanks to head coach Clint Robert. And then Tuesday I'll be speaking to the U of M Club of Flint.
Okay.
And I'll be at the game Saturday. I'll be working with you Friday. So I'll be all over the place. Then I'm going to go to Columbus and spend time with my family and my children. And then I'll be on the Big Ten Network the day before Ohio State, Michigan. So tune in to that. I'm sure I'll have some choice words for everybody and throw a few clips up there. And then Saturday, man, I'm doing the Michigan High School Athletic Association state championship games at Foote. At Ford Field. So the next 10 days should be pretty busy, but I'm still going to be here for TKA. And y'all go get them rays of light while you wanted to. Early Christmas present. Go to Amazon or go to the MDM or just email me. I'm sure I'll get some feedback from the Bobby and the Whitney and all that. I know you be liking that drama too. So do you, Ira, over there snickering. I'll see y'all in a couple of days, man.
All right, Marcus. Thanks a lot, man. Appreciate you. And as Marcus said, he will join me out at Cuter, Chrysler, Jeep, Dodge, and Ipsy for Fanatic Friday.
The last Fanatic Friday. Sam, one more ticket giveaway, one more chance to hang out with the fans during this football season.
Yeah, 3 to 6 p.m., so be sure to come on out. And really looking forward to that Fanatic Friday. Cuter, Chrysler, Jeep, Dodge, and Ipsy, 3 to 6, coming up this Friday with me and Marcus Ray, or Marcus Ray and I. It is 8:26. Back on the other side with John Beilein. We'll return here on the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 1050 WTKA, the official voice of University of Michigan sports.